Alain is from Belgium. He's an agroecologist working for over 40 years in the areas of agriculture and environmental research. He was a professor of agronomy for 20 years. He's a pioneer of organic farming in Belgium and Europe, one of the founders of Agroecology Europe and its general secretary. And he's now working with farmers and supporting them in their transition to organic farming. So over to you, Alain. We're very glad to welcome you here.
Thank you, Mr. President, for your introduction, and thank you for inviting me. I'm a university teacher and researcher, but I retired, so today I'm representative of two NGOs, the WWF Belgium and Agroecology Europe. For setting the scene, it may be interesting to show this figure, where you see in grey the evolution of beef production from the 1960s to 2010. And you see that it's relatively stable. We are at about the same production level than in 1960s. In mid-grey, it's the evolution of pig meat, and in darker grey, poultry meat. And then you see that this black line that represents soybean imports, which are very impressive. So you see that the consumption of and production, here in this case production, of pork and pig meat is highly correlated to the soybean imports. And the story began in the beginning of the 1960s, where it was agreed to in a trade negotiation between the newly created European Economic Community and the United States of America that the soybean meal, which was a byproduct, could be imported in the European Community without taxes at a time where all agricultural products were heavily taxed at the entrance of the community. And this had huge consequences. This little thing at that time had huge consequences on the evolution of European agriculture. And notably a very strong increase of pig and poultry meat production and consumption, a decrease of ruminant meat production and consumption, a conversion of permanent grassland into annual crops, including in silage maize crops in Europe, and thus an increase of pesticide use for cropping these annual crops that replaced permanent grassland, where the use of pesticides is very much reduced. It was also a strong encouragement to destroy species-rich biomes in South America later on, such as the Amazonian forest, the Cerrado, the Brazilian savanna, the Pampa, and these species-rich biomes were replaced by low species diversity arable land. And all this process induced also huge amounts of CO2 emissions in the atmosphere by destruction of the vegetation of these habitats in South America and in Europe, and the mineralization of soil organic matters in these regions. And all this process induced also the replacement of animal feed by human food in animal diets. And historically, farmers would never have used food for feeding livestock, even monogastrics. They fed pig and poultry with food waste, but not food. And this common sense principle could inspire modern agroecological systems. Because in an ideal world, ruminants should be fed on grass only. And monogastric should use grass up to, let's say, 30% of their diet, and food waste as a complement. And this food waste could come from supermarkets and large canteens and restaurants. Of course, the microbial quality of this food waste is a concern, but it's not insoluble. And actually, in the beginning of the 1960s, pig and what we can call confined animal feeding operations, the CAFO, were first located around the harbor of Rotterdam, which was and is still the main entry channel of soybean in Europe. And these new grass-based systems could be relocated around food waste sources, which would facilitate the use and the spread of their manure in good agricultural and environmental conditions, and so reduce water pollution. Ruminant production, as you know, use less soybean meal than monogastrics. Monogastrics use about the 3/4 of soybean meal imported in the EU, and beef production less than dairy. Soy became necessary in our European system when grass was replaced by silage maize, because maize is a very unbalanced feed, and I think it's useful to remind that, even if it is a good complement for feeding ruminants, it's an unbalanced feed when grass is an all-inclusive feed, because grass not only contain carbohydrates like maize, but also proteins, macro and micro minerals, and also sometimes secondary compounds such as tannins, when the proportion of dicotyledons is important in grassland. Grass-based systems are also more profitable and efficient than maize soy-based system, and that has been demonstrated in several recent studies, such as the CIVAM studies that published a synthesis of 10 years of records of the performance of grassland-based systems compared to high-input systems based on maize, soybean, fertilizers, and pesticides. And they concluded that with less land, fewer animals, and less investment, grassland-based systems generate more income, create more jobs, protect the environment better, and are more resilient to economic stress. With some colleagues, we published also recently a synthesis paper, review paper, on the comparison of conventional and agroecological systems, especially for livestock farming. And you see in this table that in different countries, the Netherlands, France, Germany, Italy, Poland, Ireland, and UK, on the basis of different economic criteria, of course. Each line is a study published in an independent paper. You see that the agroecological systems that use less concentrate, less fertilizer, and use better grass perform better from plus 10 to plus 110%. In economic terms. And we know also that in grassland-based ruminant production system, product quality is better. in some condition at least, the content of total fat and saturated fat is lower. There is a better omega-6 to omega-3 ratio, a higher CLA content. Of course, in some ruminant system, grass feeding can be complemented by ideally products produced on the farm or the region, such as cereal pulse mixture, as you see on the picture. It's triticale fodder bean, fodder pea, sorry, mixture, or by the use of local byproducts such as beet pulp or oilseed rape meal, which is also very rich in protein. And in fact, we could quite easily replace these protein in ruminant diet because lucerne, as you see here, is much more productive than soybean. And that is also not so well known. You know, a lucerne or a red clover mixed with grass can produce almost twice the protein production per hectare than soybean. And all these measures could very much reduce greenhouse gas emission and sequester carbon in grassland soils and in arable soils also with the use of temporary grassland integrated in crop rotation. So we should improve the balance between beef and pork meat. It's not exactly what we see in the media, but I'm sorry about that, but it's what I believe. Pig and poultry number should be reduced in Europe for several reasons. Total meat consumption should a bit be reduced too, but beef meat consumption could slightly grow because ruminants are needed for developing sustainable agricultural systems. Ruminants are not only methane emitters, but in a context where, you know, the price of nitrogen fertilizer will be more and more important, and we are living a crisis in the last 2-3 months. The price of nitrogen fertilizer reached 2 euro per kilo of nitrogen, which is enormous and which will have an impact on the production of food in Europe. But in the future, this trend will be maintained because the price of fossil fuel will increase, and this is strictly related with the price of nitrogen fertilizer because nitrogen fertilizer synthesis requires a lot of fossil energy for its synthesis in the Haber-Bosch process. So we need nitrogen-fixing legumes, and the most efficient legumes are perennial forage legumes. And if you produce forage, of course, for economic reasons, you have to transform this biomass into animal products, meat and milk. But by doing so, you produce also organic manure that can fertilize crops. So we need this virtuous cycle for developing the sustainable system of the future. And it has been demonstrated that these principles, these agroecological systems can feed Europe. And I refer to, for instance, this study released recently by the think tank IDRI. And you see here, I will not detail all their results, but on the right of this figure, you see the amount of kilocalorie per day and per person in Europe. On the left of this figure, 2010, on the right, 2050. And that is the proposition of this IDRI study. And they showed that it's possible to feed the Europeans by a slight increase of cereal consumption, a slight increase of grain legumes, a decrease of potato and sugar, and a decrease of several animal products, and also of soda and alcohol, but a reasonable decrease of alcohol. More grasslands mean more biodiversity. We had just a talk that mentioned that too, because grassland compared to arable land have a higher soil biodiversity, but also, of course, plant and bird biodiversity. It's also more stored carbon in the vegetation, not only in the grass, but also in the hedges, in hedgerows and so on, and sequestered carbon. But people will, of course, mention automatically methane emissions. And a recent study proposed this figure, where you see on the left, the in orange, the anthropogenic fluxes, with here rice fields, remnants, and also waste. And here you have the fossil fuel production and use. And what is also very, very spectacular in this figure, is that the emissions and the storage or the transformation of methane is huge compared to the growth rate of this gas in the atmosphere every year. And in fact, there are large uncertainties about these cycles, and that is admitted by everybody. And it is very likely that this part of the emissions from fossil fuel extraction is more probably much higher than recorded or admitted usually. And it's also important that to remind that the methane in the atmosphere is recycled in CO2. It's a short-lived gas. It is recycled after about 10 years, 12 years, and then can be reused by the vegetation. And so if the European herd, for instance, is stable for a long period, the contribution of the European herd to the increase of methane in the atmosphere is also stable. And if this European herd decreases, which is the case if you look at the number of beef and dairy cows, compared to the 1960s, we have almost the half of the number of cows we had 60 years ago. So that tends to show that the contribution to livestock production in Europe decreased in 60 years. And I am coming to my conclusion. We should produce animal products on the basis of grass, not on the basis of food. Feeding livestock with human food should be stopped. Ruminants should be fed mainly grass, monogastrics, partly grass and partly human food waste. We should have more ruminants but fewer pigs and poultry. And of course, we should eat less but better quality meat. Thank you very much.